I'd be happy to take any questions at all. Yeah?
Approximately how much time do you give your groups to do their work?
Yeah.
To do their collaboration?
So we try to base it actually on how complicated the question is. So I think it's usually between 4 and 5 minutes is a typical time. We give them a little more the first one because they have to introduce themselves and do all of that.
And then when you come back as a group, mm-hmm. how much time are you using for collaboration time?
So that's more just reviewing the answers. We typically call on one, maybe two groups then. That's where we ran into problems with time management, is we're trying to get every group to answer every question and just can't do it. So we do one or two groups. If it's a controversial thing, we may try to get a few more groups in, but most of the time it's one or two groups, and so that probably takes about 5 minutes as well.
Total time.
Yeah, I just realized, I forgot to mention their total time. So we've come up with 1 hour and 15 minutes as the perfect time. So how did we get there? Well, I think were we 90 minutes? I think we were 90 minutes the first year, and that was because we had to do that orientation for everyone every time. So we cut it back, and students said it was too long. So we cut it back a little, and this allowed us to do 3 to 4 cases. The students said, we want more cases, and then we said, well, are you willing to have another 15 minutes and have more cases? And they said, no. So 1 hour and 15 minutes seems to be about the right time. It keeps their interest. We're able to go through 3 to 4 cases, and that's what we've done the last few years. Yeah?
Who has actually buy this software?
So no one. It's free to everyone on campus. The app is free to download. If they want to use it on a computer, they just go through our course is up on Moodle, but it can be on Learn at UW. They just go through the course and click on it, and it joins them to the session.
And if we are on campus, but they're not,
doesn't matter. Yeah.
I mean, can they also download the software for free,
yeah,
or do they have to?
Yep.
Now you need a license to
set
it
up. If
you're not affiliated with the university, I think it's not free to anyone. It's free because universities,
right,
has a site license for it.
Right.
So I think that you need to have that UW.
Right, you need to set it up and run it. But people can get on from anywhere, and I've used it with groups that are not at UW.
So
and
if the participants are in Iroquois and not
mm-hmm.
UW, can they,
yeah, absolutely,
get into it as long as we have the license,
yep,
for the course?
Absolutely.
As long as you're the moderator, I think that if they try to create and set up a session,
yeah,
that won't work.
But they can participate.
Yeah, you have to log on with your NetID to be able to,
yeah, the only way
to set it up.
Create a session either through Moodle, Desire to Learn, or the portal.
Okay.
If you don't have access to one of those three as an instructor, then you can't create a session.
So can this be used by non-current students? We're not faculty. My colleague and I, we work in the International Student Services Office, and we would want to do kind of pre-arrival sessions for our students. So they're not currently enrolled yet, but would they still have access to do this?
As long as you set up the session.
As long as we set up the session, they can log in with their NetID information.
No.
You just
click,
like,
on a link.
This session right here, it'll prompt you to say, please enter your name. And anybody can do that.
Okay.
Yeah, you can. So how we do it is we have them go through the course if they're doing it on a computer. But that's one of the other issues with the, if you're doing it on a tablet, actually Moodle doesn't work very well on a tablet, and they can't seem to link properly. So then we just send them the link, and they just put the link into the app, and they get on. So you can do the same thing, just put the link into your web browser and get on that way as well.
Yeah.
And I will also just mention with that, the difference between advantage, particularly for a classroom setting, for launching it through Moodle or through Desire to Learn, is that there's an integration with the roster in the class.
Mm-hmm.
And so any student who clicks on the link through the class,
their name pops.
Blackboard Collaborate will automatically recognize them and take their portfolio or profile with them into,
yeah,
the Blackboard Collaborate. So you can't have students making up names or whatever. Whereas if you give them the generic link, whatever name they enter is what they will,
right,
be known as.
We also
Yeah, and you can track the attendance only if they go in through Moodle. If you give them the link, then we have to manually do that. It's kind of
the app, I have to actually track them now.
One thing about connecting students who haven't used it before is that orientation session. If it's going to be a one-off sort of thing, it might not be, then you've got to build to that orientation session every time. And that might be something where you, depending on what you want to do with it, you might consider something that's easier to wrap up. But this has a little bit of a wrap up to this.
Yeah.
What about video? We can see the instructor there. Is it possible to reverse that and see the participants at the end of broadcast?
Absolutely. So there's that.
Should we get in and start playing?
Yeah, there's the audio video button that I showed you here. So everyone sees these. So everyone can talk or do video. You know, you can limit how many people can be on at once. But if the students click on their video, which the first session they clicked on their video and were putting up faces and bizarre things, so we had to cut them off. these are medical students. You would think professionalism, they might understand. But so you can see the students if they choose to. If they don't click on it, then you don't see their video. So we tell them if you want to click on your video, but you don't need to.
So it would be possible for one participant to stream their video to a whole group for 20 minutes or something?
Yeah, the video of themselves or of their screen?
I'm thinking of them teaching a class or us watching.
Yeah, so if it's the video up there of them, that's easy to do. If you want them to be able to share their screen, then that's a little bit harder because then you have to give moderator privileges.
But a video of themselves.
Yeah.
So you can have this on, put it up, do something in front of it.
And you can give them moderator privileges.
Yeah,
right?
You can give them moderator privileges, but then they can change things in your session.
Right. So I would invite everybody or every table to actually just plug into your space here and share it. And mess around a little bit and see what other questions we can come up with. So one of the things that you can do right away is click on your profile and click on this little menu bar here and edit your profile. And then you can add your own picture and you put in what your first name and last name is, so that way when people click on you, you don't look like a random anonymous thing like this guy. I can go click on him and I can't see his profile because he hasn't spelled anything out. You can send private chats to people. I can send this one to James saying, "Hey, James, add a picture." Yeah. All right, so on the main screen here, I've put up Yuyen's screen. She's the moderator, so her controls are a little bit different from what you're seeing. So you might be interested in seeing that. You can see that she's got an option to record the session if she wants. And in the global preferences right around here, she can decide to set it up so that any participant can also record the session for their own.
No, there's only one recording.
There's only one recording.
There's only one recording.
But it's in your detail.
How's this angle?
Because it's a detail, right?
Well, it depends. if it's part of the integration with D2L, there's a place where recordings can show up. Same with Moodle. Same with the portal. It also gets saved on a server.
Saved everywhere.
Yeah, how it works for us, I forgot to mention that. So we record it because students may not be able to attend, and it shows up under the course. So if they go back into a session, it'll show up just as the recording for them to watch.
So you can imagine if you use it in a face-to-face classroom, you could have a study session like the night before the final or whatever, and if people didn't come to the study session, they could log in at 3 o'clock in the morning and see what had happened in that study session, which might be useful.
Two handouts that we thought we'd share with you all. I'm going to use the file transfer right now, and you will see you should see something popping up on your screen asking you to accept them.
These are the files that you shared Tuesday during your orientation session.
So one of them is the basically we have like step-by-step instructions that we send to the students ahead of time,
okay,
telling them how to sign in and stuff like that. The other one is just a template that we use for each of the topic conference. So that includes some slides that just, you know, explain to the students what to do during the breakout session.
But that is the way that we share files. Usually at the beginning of one of the web conferences, we share the cases and the questions with students this way, and any other information.
One thing to note is, you'll notice even on the students, you can, as a student, you can save the chat. So for whatever reason, you will save as a text file. If there's questions that were asked or answered via the chat, you can save that. You can also save the whiteboard. And for attendance purposes, particularly if you're not using an integration with one of the learning management systems, you can always just save the participants list as a text file, and that will give you a listening session.
That is actually what we use, is not what we show up.
So does the file share work with the app as well? I guess
I
haven't
I wouldn't surprise me if it didn't. It's really not at the back of this app.
Not possible to draw from the app, is that? Is it possible to do the drawing on the whiteboard from the app?
From what I know about the app is there's audio. I believe you can end up in a break room, and I think you can see the whiteboard. I don't think you can interact with the whiteboard. And I think that's basically all you can do on the app.
Could we try a breakout?
Yeah, should we try a breakout session?
Yeah, you guys want to try a breakout session?
If you watch Yuyen, you'll see how she does it, because there's various options
this one says
when you're setting it up.
I think we have,
you can say
number of rooms, or you can say divide into groups of.
Everybody
would
see me.
Oh, yeah. So we can say, let's have a group of three. I think I tested this out once to see how the maximum number of breakout rooms you could have, and I was able to do like hundreds.
Yeah, I think somebody successfully created 499 breakout rooms. So.
And then you have to visit each one through the course of the class.
One thing that Feldstein and I always do, we put ourselves into a breakout room. I mean, the different breakout rooms, just to make sure they are actually talking and nobody's having audio problems.
Yeah, well, the nice thing is, so we know that the students are actually interacting in the breakout rooms because we kind of pop ourselves in and see what's going on. And they're looking up stuff online. They're really interacting on the questions. And so it's really pretty cool to see. Some of the faculty love to go through and hear the different discussions, and then they can bring that up when they bring everyone back to the large group. You can decide whether you announce. I always announce when I go into a room, but you can decide if you want to or not.
So we also use a timer. As soon as we put them in a room, we give them like 5 minutes or something, and then the timer goes off, and then all I have to do is to go to your participants.
Do you
want to
type on the whiteboard?
Yeah. So if you've been put into a breakout room, do you see anything on your whiteboard?
No, the whiteboard's blank.
It's blank.
You should be able to share.
Right.
Because
so,
you just share the.
Right. If you want the students to see that, then you have to share the. You can have a private page too. That's cool.
And you can decide whether all the breakout rooms see it or not.
So now you can share. And then you can actually pull these, right? We can manipulate and
right.
do whatever.
Yeah.
So if you wanted to have students do some kind of exercise, then you can pull all those exercises back together.
And then show them the name. So we tell them at the beginning the timer is going to go off, and then we usually give them about 10 seconds after the timer goes off and bring them back. So at least they can see the timer and see the time counting down, and then
prepare accordingly.
Oh, you can see the timer. Oh, and the app, you can't see the app. Yeah, the app does have
limitations.
So
because we're in the same breakout room,
it's just easier.
So she's asking the blue, this
They just brought us back out of the breakout.
So we're all now back in the main room.
Big Brother is taking control of
That's right.
So this is actually one of the great things about it. It's like in class when you have groups and you're like, okay, time to come back, and sometimes they take longer. And this is just like, boom, guess what? You're done.
You're done. And then you can't go back in
You can set it so participants can move themselves in what breakout rooms, but you can also continue to be an almighty wizard.
That's a little hectic. Well, it depends how many you have, of course, but if you have 60 people, you can't have everyone going back and forth between rooms, and then you have to teach them how to do that. It's actually quite easy. You just pull yourself into a room, so we do it. You just grab your name from the side here and drag it into whichever room you want, if you're the moderator. So students could do that as well, but we chose not to allow them to.
So one way of doing that is there's another tool called Unconference that is on the back of your
Unhangout,
that is based on Unconferences. And Unhangout uses Google Hangouts to have breakout rooms. And the way that Unconferences work is generally there's this lobby, at least in Unhangouts, there's this lobby where people can say, hey, we're going to have in breakout room 7, we're going to have this conversation. And in breakout room 2, we're going to have a discussion on whatever the other thing is. So then students can, it's much more of an affinity-based conference. They can go choose what session they want to go to, like a conference, but they're kind of, they spring up automatically. They're not sort of predetermined necessarily. And that gives the participants more of the choice. So there are pros and cons to both, right? Because in that model, you might have somebody who's all excited and nobody shows up to their thing because right next door, there's a much more exciting topic, or at least one with a better title.
So do people want to see some other tools? Like I was just following.
Yes. Well, are there any other questions? We have 5 more minutes left, so I want to make sure that we have all the questions.
Accessibility issues in terms of, if you have a person that is deaf or something like that, like how are there ways to, help those people and fit it?
Not that I know of in the tool. Okay. I mean,
I'd have to look into it. I know that Blackboard as a company is supposedly supposed to be big on accessibility. So I have to look into it. Can you get closed captions or something
that? Well, you can. So interestingly enough, if you don't have a computer with a microphone, there's something called, was it telephony? So you can get on and it basically hooks in. You have to dial into it. It's a long distance number, actually.
It's a Virginia number.
But then you come in as a teleconference, and whoever says that they want to do telephone, they all wind up on that same line. So that theoretically could do with the TV.
And the other thing to keep in mind with that is typically you can only have 6 simultaneous audio or video in a session, but anybody who calls in on telephone, so if you wanted to have everybody on telephone, you could literally have everybody be able to talk, but then again, you'd have everybody be able to talk. You also wouldn't be able to mute them or anything like that, whereas if it's through the void, you could.
Okay. I had another question too.
And we've been on those telephone, Ryan and I gave a conference on Collaborate, and they use that telephone thing. And there was somebody who had a whole drama going on in the background, and they forgot that they were on the telephone. So it was sort of a.
There was about 800 people on that call.
It was an interesting mess.
Oh, wow.
But then it's like any teleconference, right? Where you mute your own phone.
And it gets back to David's point as far as preparation, right?
Right.
You can do that as long as you prepare the students ahead of time. This is what it's going to be like. This is what you need to do. This is what to expect.
Mm-hmm. I have one more question about the PowerPoint. I was trying to kind of mess around with this in my office and uploading a PowerPoint, but I found that I could only access it maybe 30 minutes before the actual session. Is that?
So you can set that up. So
okay.
Yuyen has hours open up about 30 minutes. So that she can get everything uploaded in time.
Okay.
So it depends on, you set when it opens and when it closes, mm-hmm. so you can set that. So you can make it open earlier so that you can upload everything earlier. But it means that then anyone can get into the room once it's open.
Okay. So there's not really a way to kind of, I was thinking just, you know, to review the PowerPoint, make sure it's fluid and everything prior to.
You can. But so what happens is you go in, you set up, you allow yourself X minutes early entry. So
okay.
Everybody who gets an invite, it will say session starts at 11 a.m. But you can actually start getting in starting at 10:15 a.m.
Okay.
Now, and there's also a setting when you're the moderator where you can keep anybody from joining the session.
Okay.
So you could do that if you're concerned about people coming in before you're ready. But a couple things along this topic to be aware of. Number one, Blackboard Collaborate flushes. Which means once everybody logs out of the session, everything uploaded to that session is gone. I mean, unless you recorded it. But we won't get into why they do that, or why they say they do that. So you can't like go in the day before, upload a PowerPoint file, and then show up and it'll be there. That's not how it works.
So like any tool, the best way to be comfortable in it is to live in it and have multiple practice sessions.
And right. And one other thing I will mention very quickly is that when you create a session, you can create a session that lasts for up to a year.
Yeah.
So you can just have people come back to the same room repeatedly, and it will, if you're worried about recordings, every time you record, every time everybody leaves the session, it will generate a new recording.
James, can you tell us about the age of Ultron?
Yeah. So Blackboard Collaborate has some really nice affordances like the breakout room and whatnot. And the main reason why we have it on this campus is because you can have as many people in session as you want, and it doesn't cost more. They recognize that it's Java-based. It's got a lot of glitches in that sense. It takes a lot to get people used to it. And so they've developed a new product called Ultra, which we have a kind of an early evaluation / semi-pilot period going right now. It's much slicker in that you don't have to download anything. You literally just click a link and you're there. It's browser-based, so there's no Java. It doesn't take long to upload. The problem for people like David and Yuyen is that it doesn't have all the features built in yet. The roadmap is eventually they'll have breakout rooms. They currently don't have breakout rooms. The roadmap is eventually they'll have telephony. They currently don't have telephony. But it is, and for certain use cases, it's a much nicer product than Blackboard Collaborate, and it is something that we will have access to. And then the final thing is we have a contract for this tool through the UW system through spring of 2016. It is unclear whether we'll be renewing that contract or not. There will be a web conferencing tool of some kind. We're also piloting Skype for Business. We have Google Hangouts, etc. But the future is a bit murky.
And we are just about out of time. I'd like to encourage you to please fill out the evaluation, because that helps us with our planning for next year. And please help me thank David and Yuyen.